Hey everyone, it's time for Good Week Israel. Well, we'll give you ILTV's latest positive highlights. So get ready to smile because coming up, the IDF has the potential to become TikTok famous. We'll show you some boutique hotels you can stay at in Jerusalem. And if you're looking for a TV show to binge because you're bored of the ones on Netflix, you're gonna wanna listen up. So yada, let's get started. This is one of those only in Israel stories. A 13-year-old Israeli boy was foraging for mushrooms following the recent rain when he stumbled upon something unbelievable, a stone slab with a Greek inscription that is believed to be thousands of years old.
הלכנו לתוף פטריות, שלפתע הוא קורא לי, אומר לי, אבא, בוא תראה משהו. באתי, ניגשתי ונדהמתי לראות את האבן הזאת, היפה הזאת, שהיא מקושטת בכל מיני איתורים.
Stav Meir is just in 7th grade, and he was out hunting for wild mushroom with his family in Caesarea when he noticed something strange, a stone slab sticking out of the ground that was most likely brought to the surface by the downpour. Meir says he immediately recognized it was something ancient because he studies archaeology in school with the Israeli Antiquities Authority.
אני שמח שבעקבות הלימודים האלה הוא בעצם קיבל את הכישורים לבוא ולהגיד, מצאתי משהו, יש לזה ערך, זה בעל ערך.
Well, the 13-year-old was certainly right about the value of his discovery. The IAA has identified this slab as a Byzantine burial inscription, engraved in Greek with a cross. The identity of the deceased reads, the grave of Anastasius or Anastasia, according to researchers. They say that in ancient times, Caesarea was a center of attraction for a wealthy population, and that the quality of the slab discovered indicates that the person entombed probably had a lot of money. Well, little Stav Meir has now been awarded a certificate of appreciation from the Israel Antiquity Authority, and he'll give a special lesson to his class for the discovery that he made.
Earlier this month, reports came out that Israel's border police banned their officers from using the Chinese social media app TikTok. But clearly the IDF hasn't taken this too seriously. For those of you who don't know about the platform, it's an app where users film themselves in short videos, dancing, lip-syncing, or creating funny videos. So apparently uploading videos to this social media app could compromise Israel's security and could potentially harm the reputation of Israeli organizations such as the IDF. The IDF has created, anyway, its very own TikTok account. Take a look.
So, what's life like in the Israeli army? Well, the IDF's new account on the Chinese social media app TikTok definitely gives us an idea. Check out this video showing a shooting practice. Or there are also a few videos on the account that will for sure make you cry. The first one, you can see two brothers reuniting after a long time apart. Then two sisters reuniting and breaking down in tears. And then the one that every mother could relate to. How about the video where the unit's officer starts beatboxing and at the end tells them their drill is canceled because of the terrible weather? You can also see some of the many talents of the IDF soldiers. And how about the reigning paratroopers? It's raining men! Alleluia, it's raining men! Hey, men! Basically, anyone that follows the IDF official TikTok account will understand why Israelis are so proud of their army. Well, this unique look into the IDF may all come to an end if the government decides to step in. The United States Army has actually already banned the Chinese app itself, stating that the company behind TikTok could be compelled to provide data and intelligence to the Chinese Communist Party.
Israel is getting closer and closer to sending their judokas off to Japan for the Summer 2020 Olympics, and we have two winners on our hands after our home victories.
Israel is getting closer and closer to sending their judokas off to Japan for the Summer 2020 Olympics. That's right, we have two winners on our hands after last week's home victories. and it's nice to win on your home turf, or should we say on the home mat. Oli Sasson and Peter Palchik have each taken home a gold medal in judo in the Grand Prix competition, which was hosted right here in Tel Aviv, and both won in the 100 kilo and under 100 kilo categories respectively. Sasson has taken to Facebook to say that the win brings lots of happiness to his heart, but this isn't his first either. Sasson took home the bronze medal during the 2016 Brazil Olympics, and he plans to compete again in Tokyo this summer. The next match for both of Israel's judoka champions will be on February 8th in Paris.
While only 1% of people will develop a malignant brain tumor in their life, 95% of those who suffer from the strongest strain will succumb to the illness. In an effort to turn those numbers around, Israeli researchers have come up with a way to use electric pulses to take down tumors.
It's called glioblastoma, or GBM. And if you know anything about it, you know that this aggressive form of brain cancer kills 95% of its victims. And until now, treatment has been sparse. Israeli researchers have now come out with a device that zaps tumors using electric pulses. And the innovative treatment is now going to be streamlined into Israel's socialized healthcare system. It's called the Optune, a netted cap using TT fields or tumor-treating fields, which are alternating electric fields to specifically target cancer cells without causing too much harm to nearby healthy ones. The device is meant for patients who have been recently diagnosed with GBM or are going through chemotherapy. The Optune was developed by an Israeli biotech firm called Novocure. One patient suffering from the disease tried the cap mid-chemotherapy. He says while the cancer doesn't seem to improve, the treatment has prevented his condition from getting any worse. Novocure has gotten FDA approval and is approved in Europe, Canada, and the United States.
For over 150 years, the world has celebrated Vincent van Gogh as one of the world's most influential modern artists of all time. And van Gogh's latest showcase is being exhibited right here in Israel. Check this out.
Imagine being able to take a look into the mind of the world-famous artist Vincent van Gogh. Well, now you can, right here in Israel. Vincent van Gogh's latest showcase, Van Gogh the Exhibition, has been shown in some of the world's most prestigious museums, and now Israel is its latest stop. Over 900 of Van Gogh's famous paintings are being brought to life through a unique sound and light show, as well as a must-see virtual reality tour. Unlike during his lifetime, people can truly appreciate his artworks for what they are. True masterpieces. The exhibit itself is currently being held in the Arena complex in the city of Herzliya, just a short 15-minute drive from Tel Aviv. Van Gogh only began painting at the age of 27 and died at 37, but managed to create two paintings per week. The exhibit itself has already been shown in Brussels, Naples, and Beijing, so make sure not to miss out on your chance to see it in the Holy Land.
A new city for the first time, you typically ask for recommendations from friends on where to stay or simply check the TripAdvisor website. But when you're getting ready to visit Jerusalem, don't bother wasting your time because I'm about to show you two top hotels you should totally check out. When planning your visit to Israel, one of the main locations to visit is always the capital city of Jerusalem. So I'm about to show you a few of the top boutique hotels that you can stay at so that you're next to all the major sites in the city. Our first stop is the Biazi Hotel, located in the Nachalat Achim neighborhood right here in Jerusalem.
The Biazi Hotel was built in honor to my late father, Eliyahu Biazi, in a place where he lived as a child in his family's two rooms house.
When you first get into this hotel, you get a rundown on the history of the Biazi family, the building itself, and all the artifacts that decorate the hotel.
The hotel was designed to give the guests the sense of his unique spirit.
The hotel has six rooms, all labeled with different types of desserts in honor of Biazi, who used to be a gourmet baker.
התמונה הזאת היא הדיוקן של אבא שלי, שהיא עשויה בעצם ממטבעות ישנות. יש פה 3,000 אגורות שהיו לפני שהיה שקל.
Now we're off to the next hotel. The Pamonim Hotel has a luxury and modern design concept and is a short distance from the Old City, which is where you can find some of Jerusalem's holiest sites.
The hotel is actually a family-run business with huge love for Jerusalem. We are a 10th generation family in the city, so we know the city like the back of our hands.
The Pamonim Hotel is right in the center of the city and is 2 steps away from the light rail that takes you all over Jerusalem. The hotel focuses on employee diversity, with workers from Christian, Arabic, Jewish, and all different types of religious backgrounds. The management team at this hotel are almost all family. There are brothers and sisters, aunts and uncles, all working together at the Pamonim.
We can share with our guests all the hidden spots that Jerusalem has to offer. And the really cool thing about it, that it's just walking distance from the hotel. We really try to make our guests feel at home.
TV, you're either portrayed as inspiring or as the source of pity, and I'm sick of it. That's what Israeli producer Asaf Greenbaum has to say about how people with disabilities are represented in the media. And that's why he just launched a new 3-part documentary series that delves into the personal lives of people with handicaps. Take a look.
אני בת 23 ואני רוצה להיות סקסית ויפה וזה הכל
אוקיי, אז מה, אתה מרגיש?
כן
התמונות שהייתי מפרסמת באינסטגרם ובפייסבוק היו נטולות כיסא
אני לא מספר לפני דייטים שאני נכה
אתה מסתיר משהו באישיות שלך
תפריד כבר את הנכות ממי שאתה כבן אדם
את המגבלות שלנו, גם לכם יש.
Perfect. That's the name of this groundbreaking new Israeli docu-series. How do you have sex? When do you tell your date that you're disabled? These are just some of the questions that 5 Israelis with disabilities are asked to answer. From cerebral palsy to paralysis, the show's stars all face a range of different handicaps. But they're on a mission to change how the world views them by speaking openly and honestly about issues of self-image, their relationships, and sexuality in a way that most of us haven't seen before. The show's creator and producer Asaf Greenbaum is handicapped himself and says this docuseries is all about changing the narrative that exists around the disabled community.
Wildfires across Australia have killed dozens of people and billions of animals, destroying massive amounts of land along the way. And putting these fires out is a very dangerous job. Well, now an Israeli defense firm is coming to the rescue with a new and less risky method to douse the flames.
So how do you put out a massive wildfire? It's risky business, but it's a business that the Israeli security firm Elbit now says they have a solution for. Imagine being able to drop massive amounts of flame retardant on wildfires from high, high above. Well, that's exactly what the system Hydrop does. Using it, firefighting aircraft can extinguish burning fields from a minimum altitude of 500 meters. That's 4 times higher than the current average altitude for today's firefighting systems. Currently, firefighting aircraft have to fly low and during the day only, because they make their way through smoke, ash, and hidden terrain, posing extreme risk to the crew. You see, the fire retardant liquid that they're dropping isn't effective from higher up, but Hydrop, on the other hand, uses flame retardant and biodegradable pellets that can be dropped from 500 to 2,000 meters above. And it even has a 95% success rate for hitting its target day or night, thanks to its auto-sensory capabilities. But best of all, the Israeli system can be outfitted to almost any aircraft in just a few minutes, which significantly reduces response times.
Some say that the tiniest country in the world is located within Israel's borders. Achziv Land is a little micronation on Israel's coast, and it's known as the beacon of peace in the Middle East. Take a look.
There's only one country in the Middle East that has never engaged in a military conflict. It's called Achzivland. Achzivland is a micronation in northern Israel near the Lebanese border. And there's only one citizen that lives here. Her name's Rina.
הגעתי ב-64, 71 זה הכרזת המדינה היה.
Her husband, Eli Avivi, founded Achzivland back in 1971, and he served as president until he passed away last year. But boy, has he left a legacy. The pacifist little nation of Achzivland has become a major tourist attraction.
There's a little museum, guest houses, a beach campground. You can get your own little passport stamped when you visit. And of course, listen to the national anthem.
ההמנון של אחזיב זה מיית גלי הים.
So how did Achzivland become its own little sovereign state? Well, it all started when Eli Avivi moved in. Eli immigrated to current-day Israel from Iran. And in 1952, he decided to settle at the ruined village of Achziv. He lived among the dilapidated buildings with his wife Rina until the Israeli government decided to try and turn the area into a military base and then later a national park.
הראשון שאלי גר, הרסו אותו, ושהרסו את הבית, וכבר לא ידענו מה לעשות, ואמרנו, אנחנו נלחם על הבית שלנו, שלא יהרסו לנו עוד. אז החלטנו, בגלל המלחמה על הבית, רוצים לא להיות בישראל, להכריז על המקום כמדינה, מדינת אכזיב. החזרנו את התעודות זהות.
For years, Achzivland was a hippie haven, putting visiting guests to work and holding an annual rock festival.
עשינו את הבוסטוק הישראלי.
Here in Achzivland, residents have always had their own flag, democracy, and independence, but they don't actually have any police force, army, or power.
הממשל פה באחזיב זה דמוקרטי, אבל בבחירות הוא בוחר בעצמו הכי טוב. הוא גם נשיא וגם מלך. אלי בחר בעצמו להיות הכל. הכלכלה זה רק מהתיירות שנכנסת למקום. היחסים שלנו עם כל מדינות העולם, 100%, ובעיקר עם מדינת ישראל. הצבא של אחזיב, זה רק החברים, חברים מכל העולם שבאים ונלחמים בשבילנו.
Israel still refuses to recognize Achzivland as a sovereign nation, but the future of the state remains clear to Rina.
המוזיאון והמורשת יישארו גם לדורות הבאים. מקום כזה אין לו מחיר, זה צריך להישאר כמו שהוא.
Let's take a look at some videos that are going absolutely viral right here in Israel.
שבי יפה. ארצה. שבי. שפן. קנגרו. אחורה. 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 שבי. טוב. ארצה.
אוקיי, זהוי אחי, זה היה חלש ואין לי כוח לשמוע את זה, אני מוטש. היום יום שלישי, מחכה לסופש ונראה לי כולן ללכת כי אבל תגיע לי חוזרש.
For the Torah portion with Sandra Oster Barris, director of the Christian Friends of Israeli Communities in Heartland.
Today's Torah portion is Bo, and in it we have the story of the final episodes just before the children of Israel are released from Egypt. We have the last few plagues. in between all of this drama, we have God's commandments to Moses, to the children of Israel, to bring the Passover sacrifice and to do a number of other things. As part of these instructions, we have the following statement. You should tell your children on that day, because of this, God has done this for me in taking me out of Egypt. What is the meaning of that sentence? The statement that is being made to the children is that because of this, what is this? Because of these commandments, because of the Passover sacrifice, because of all the other, the tefillin, the phylacteries, and other things that we need to do, for that reason, God will take us, has taken us out of Egypt. He takes us, the children of Israel, out of Egypt so that we may obey his commandments and obey him and serve God. Later on, earlier, we have a similar statement. When God says, there's going to be another couple of plagues I'm still yet to bring, and I'm going to harden Pharaoh's heart. Why does he harden his heart? And this is what he says. So that you may say to your children and your grandchildren everything that I did to Pharaoh. Here we have a similar situation, but opposite. Again, telling the children and the grandchildren. But here, God is doing something. He is going to magnify the miracle of the Exodus so that the telling of the story will be magnified and make that much of a greater impression on the children and the grandchildren. These two ideas are at the center of the Passover Seder. The Jews celebrate and have celebrated for centuries from the time of the Exodus until today. Jews all over the world, wherever they are, gather together as a family and retell the story of the Exodus from Egypt. And it's not just retelling the story. It is fulfilling this commandment of telling the children and the grandchildren. It is the obligation that God put upon us from our very inception, not just to know something, but to take upon us the obligation to pass it on to the future generations. And it is this responsibility to our future generations that not only lies at the core of the Seder, but lies at the core of all of our existence. The Jewish people that has survived exile and dispersion all over the world, we have remained a people because we have always looked out to pass on our traditions to the next generation. That is the essence of Judaism. This is Sandra Osterberis bringing you a few words of the Bible from the heart of biblical Israel.
That's all for today's Good Week Israel. Hope we've helped you start your week off with a smile. I'm Emmanuel Kadosh, and see you next week.